Hello everyone, and welcome to this week's episode of Pulp Crazy. I'm your host, Jason Aiken. In this week's episode, I'll be getting into the holiday spirit with Krampusnacht by Josh Reynolds. It's a short story that features the Royal Occultist, Charles Saint Cyprian, and his apprentice, Ebe Gallowglass. Saint Cyprian holds the post of the Royal Occultist, sometimes called the Queen's Conjurer. The post was first held by the historical figure, John Dee, during the reign of Queen Elizabeth I. Other notable royal occultists include the First Earl of Holderness, as well as Thomas Carnacki the Ghost-Finder. The Royal Occultist is an ongoing series of stories. Reynolds has written both short fiction and novels based around the Royal Occultist character. There have been numerous pieces of short fiction published, with more on the way. The two Royal Occultist novels are titled The Whitechapel Demon and the recently released The Jade Suit of Death. As of this episode, the adventures take place between 1913 and 1925. In the three earlier tales, Saint Cyprian is working alongside Carnacki as his apprentice. However, the meat of the series seems to take place in the early to mid-1920s. The series definitely falls into the occult detective subsection of weird fiction, but it also has ties into the Wold Newton universe of Philip Jose Farmer. The inclusion of the historical John Dee, as well as the fictional occult detective Thomas Carnacki, as part of the series' background, is very much in the spirit of Philip Jose Farmer's Wold Newton concept. John Dee is a historical figure who lived from 1527 until 1608 or 1609, as his exact date of death is not certain. Thomas Carnacki was created by English writer William Hope Hodgson and appeared in six short stories between 1910 and 1912 in English magazines. Pulp writer August Derleth penned three Carnacki short stories that were published posthumously. One of the stories, The Hog, was published in Weird Tales in 1947. However, the most direct connection to Philip Jose Farmer's Wold Newton family is the inclusion of the First Earl of Holderness as holding the position of Royal Occultist. The Duke of Holderness is a character in the Sherlock Holmes story, The Adventure of the Priory School, written by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Reynolds spells the name slightly different than Doyle, but it's definitely the same family. In his biography of Tarzan, Tarzan Alive, Philip Jose Farmer displayed the connection between the Duke of Holderness and the Tarzan series. Farmer postulates that the name Holderness is a literary disguise that Doyle used, just as Edgar Rice Burroughs used Greystoke as a disguise of the true family name in the Tarzan series. Both Holderness and Greystoke are literary disguises for the same noble family. Farmer postulated the Duke of Holderness in The Adventures of the Priory School is actually Tarzan's uncle, who has inherited the title of Duke of Holderness when Tarzan's father went missing at sea. The Duke of Holderness that appears in The Adventures of the Priory School is actually the sixth Duke of Holderness. Farmer also designates Tarzan as the eighth Duke. In the Greystoke lineage, an addendum to Tarzan Alive, Farmer gives us some information on the first Duke of Greystoke, or Holderness. Born in 1703, the first Duke was a child prodigy in music and foreign languages. He was also a world traveler, visiting Egypt and the Holy Lands. Though there is no mention in Farmer's text about occult activity, it is revealed that the first Duke was close to King George II of England. The Duke and the King shared an interest in music, and the Duke often loaned the King vast sums of money. Most of the money would not be repaid, but the Duke could afford it thanks to his profitable trade in goods and slaves in North America, the West Indies, and West Africa. Farmer's text also states that although the Duke never held public office, he still had great influence on the King. Since the Royal Occultist is not a public office, but rather an open secret, I think this still fits within Farmer's framework. It's mentioned in Farmer's work that the first Duke traveled to the North American colonies to fight in the French and Indian War. He published a journal in 1754 that chronicled him being captured, tortured, and his eventual escape from the Cayugas. He lost an eye during the torture, and his right leg due to an infection from a wound from a bear during his flight. Upon his return to England, the first Duke saved the King from a Jacobite assassin, and the King created the title of Duke and Viscount Greystoke as a reward for his services. He remained Duke and Viscount of Greystoke until 1765, when he fell from a horse while hunting with his son and passed away. Although Farmer provided a nice broad outline of the first Duke and his exploits, I think there is still enough room left in there for him to be the Royal Occultist on the side. Heck, those wounds he received in North America may not have been from the Cayuga tribe or a bear. Maybe he was there undercover, hunting a supernatural entity of some sort, although that's just pure speculation on my part. There's another connection between Reynolds and Farmer. Reynolds has also written an authorized sequel to Philip Jose Farmer's The Other Log of Phileas Fogg. It's titled Phileas Fogg and the War of Shadows, published by Meteor House Press. I reviewed it for the Lovecraft e-zine, and will include a link to it in the show notes. It should be noted that copies of this limited edition novella are very limited. From what I understand, the supplies are running kind of low. So if you are interested in purchasing Phileas Fogg and the War of Shadows, I suggest you get in touch with Meteor House ASAP via their website, email, or Facebook page. I'll put them all in the show notes. Now, I've only read a few of the Royal Occultist short stories, so I'm not sure how much deeper Reynolds gets into the First Earl of Holderness, but I'm looking forward to checking out the rest of these to see if there's any mention of him. Since he's the First Earl of Holderness, he's technically a member of the Wool Newton family, a pre-meteor strike member of the family. Now, as for the two Royal Occultist stories I've read, they're titled The Bells of Northam, which was published in Lovecraft e-zine issue 27, and this story, Krampusnacht, which I read in the Royal Occultist primer. Given the holiday theme, I'll be discussing Krampusnacht. Krampusnacht is actually available in two collections that are on the Royal Occultist website. It's available for free in the Royal Occultist primer, which can be downloaded in PDF, and it also includes other stories in there too. Krampusnacht is also available in the Royal Occultist Haunted Holidays collection. It's comprised of Royal Occultist holiday theme tales, and that's available in multiple ebook formats off the website. Haunted Holidays is on the site as a free download, but Reynolds requests you make a one-time donation to the charity of your choice after downloading. In Krampusnacht, Saint Cyprian and Gallowglass go up against the Krampus of Germanic folklore. Like Santa Claus, he comes on Christmas Eve, but he isn't bringing presents. He's coming to punish people who have misbehaved. The Krampus is often depicted as a chained, bestial demon. The story opens on Christmas Eve, and the Krampus is after Oswald Rodden, a former acquaintance of St. Cyprian, who is a gambler, a lout, and also a war hero, as described in the text. He apparently saved St. Cyprian's life during World War I. Since the war ended, Rodden hasn't been on his best behavior, and has even murdered someone. Hence, the Krampus is on his trail. The story deals with St. Cyprian and Gallowglass hearing Rodden out, and attempting to defend him from the creature. Some of the highlights of the story include a device previously used by Carnacki, and other interesting supernatural equipment used by occult detectives that St. Cyprian and Gallowglass have on hand. Ebe Gallowglass is quite an interesting character. She's very capable in a pinch, and is kind of like Emma Peel if St. Cyprian is John Steed. If you are a fan of occult detectives, weird fiction, and Philip Jose Farmer's Wold Newton universe, you owe it to yourself to pick up the two collections and give this a try. I don't think you'll be disappointed. You can find links to the collections, novels, and other available short stories online in the show notes. Well, that's it for this week's episode. Pulp Crazy is located at pulpcrazy.com. I'm at Pulp Crazy on Twitter and facebook.com/pulpcrazy. My YouTube channel is located at youtube.com/pulpcast. You can also email me at pulpcrazy@gmail.com. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.